when you thought there was nothing left for you to do with your night. The Revolver Podcast, Mama Hot Flash, crew is hot, always doing you right. With a fresh take on gaming weekly, PCs, consoles, and handhelds. Bump what you heard since birth on this earth. We know that the future belongs to the nerds. Revolve Alive.
What you say?
Revolve Alive every Sunday at 6, bringing that gaming magic to your life. Doing it live on Twitch, the show that you don't want to miss. Be sure to subscribe. Crack yourself a brew. If it work, are you who? Now you can join the crew for the ride.
Xbox, mobile, and hot topics around the nation. To gaming rigs, headsets, hardware, and PlayStation. Shout out to Joe. Can't you see him glow? Token brother brought the flow. Now it's time for the show.
Let's go. What's going on, guys? Welcome to Revolver Live, the podcast with more information than Encyclopedia Britannica, but it's more information that you actually want to hear. Today, we're joined by amazing four hosts. Today, we're joined by Briar Rabbit, the god of Destiny, who'll be more angry than Kratos when Destiny 2 beta ends. Of course, we've got Gary Diaz, who, of course, makes us sound more amazing.
His name.
We got this motherfucker right here.
Thug Life! What's going on, everybody? Welcome. Welcome to Revolver Live. We got Gary. We got Wilson, who actually shaved his beard so we could see his lips move. We're used to having the little thumbnail and PNG in the background. And me, the Beastly Gamer, who you guys never thought could rap. And I guess I proved that wrong. Welcome to Revolver Live, guys. A show with six topics revolving around the table that range from video game topics to popular nerd culture. And also, we want you guys' feedback in the future as well. And you guys will be able to send that in to our email address, which I'm totally missing right now because I'm not reading. But welcome to episode one. We're going to get this show going, and we're going to do some exciting new things today with Revolver Live.
Dude, I am so hyped for this show, man. Like, it has been, what have we been working on this show for, 6 weeks now?
Four weeks?
Like, it's been a long time working on this show. And, you know, we did all the stupid promos. Beastly did the hot rap, which was not stupid at all.
Right.
But, I mean, it was just, we've been, like, building and building and building up to this point, and now we're freaking live, man. We're doing it live!
Doing it live.
Bill O'Reilly, we are doing it live, man. I'm really excited about this. This is a great new venture. Moving this show in a new, completely new direction. Doing something completely different for you guys. The days of old are gone, and I think that the direction we're going with Revolver Live is going to benefit you guys more so than any other time in the past. Welcome to Revolver Live.
Yeah, I'd like to start actually with a sad story, because being a professional podcast as we are now, I actually thought we need a sponsor. Definitely need a sponsor. So Brian and I have been working on the download with Trojan Condoms to you know, come up and support the show, something that we believe in strongly. We were trying out a new line, actually modeled on our own host here. We were calling it the Briar, but when they did their market research, most people just got it confused with a shower curtain, so they had to pull the line, so that fell apart. So here we are, unsponsored, but we're here for you anyway.
I was always more of a Magnum guy anyway.
Me too, Wilson. Me too, brother.
Not so much over here.
first dick joke, boom.
Boom, knocked it out of the park. Got it right out of the way. Got the dick jokes handled. Mm-hmm. Got it covered. Yep. Yo, I'm really excited about the format of the show, too. As Beasley said before, we got basically the whole theme of the show is six topics. Sometimes they're going to be gaming related. Sometimes they're not going to be gaming related. Sometimes they'll be pop culture. Sometimes they're going to come out of left field. We are gamers, though, so a lot of times it's going to be gaming.
Mostly, but yeah.
Got six shots out of the barrel, ready to go. You want to start off with the topics?
Yeah, let's get into them.
All right, let's do
it. We should.
Let's do it.
Right. Well, the first topic we're going to have a look at is, I don't know if anyone played it, actually. There was a beta for a first-person shooter that came out this week. It wasn't a big title. It was a sequel, actually, to a game that I heard died years ago. Actually, Destiny 2. Has anyone played it? What did you think?
Did you guys play that?
Yeah, I've been playing it nonstop. I'm not even gonna front. I'm not even gonna make the joke.
It's never hard heard to of front,
it.
Isn't it?
Not even gonna start off with the not even heard of it bullshit. I've been playing this thing nonstop. In fact, I was just spent like 3 hours in the social area because it turns out they weren't kicking you out. You could only get in for an hour. So I spent like 3 hours there trying to uncover every freaking secret I could find. And that was just walking around. You couldn't even do anything in there except for kick a soccer ball around. We got two modes of PvP in it. We got a strike and we got some we got a story mission. And I got to say, it whet my appetite but did not fulfill what I'm hoping to expect. I'm looking forward to the main course, guys. What did you guys think about it? Did you like what you saw? Did you hate what you saw? Did it get you excited? Did it come with a lot of reservations about the future for Destiny 2? A lot of us are big Destiny gamers here, and Wilson's huge. Gary's on and off.
and until it comes to PC, usually off. But as the guy who plays Destiny probably the least on Revolver Show, let me just say this: you know, I played Destiny 1. I really enjoyed it. My wife and I, we went through the story campaign, which was incredible. You know, going through the demolition of the tower and seeing exactly how they brought those characters that we, you know, got so close to in the original game, but never really got a chance to see them do anything, to see them actually pull out golden guns and protect everybody and feel like you're a part of that environment. And then to see that strike, to me, the strike felt very similar to a raid. It was so difficult to me. You know, it was me and two other players, my wife and some asshole. I don't know who the guy was, but we went through it. And it was so difficult, and I was like, wow, this is really something that's keeping me attached and making me want to see exactly what they're going to do in the future with Destiny 2. I really liked it. You guys know, and I'm sure you guys will elaborate, we played a hell of a lot of Crucible together the day before yesterday. That's probably right. About two or three hours, and that was the most fun I've had in Destiny, honestly, guys, in years. It was really, really incredible. Give me you guys' thoughts. What do you guys think?
I've been having a blast with it. First thing, obviously, you do when you jump in, you select, you know, whether you want to be a Titan, Hunter, Warlock, and it throws you right into the cinematic opening of the first story mission. And man, I got to tell you, there was a lot of feels, a lot of good storytelling there. It really set the tone for the fight is coming to us. And it was really good the way they told the first story mission. It was different than the one that was at the reveal. There was a little bit more stuff than what they showed at the reveal, so I was happy about that. Then once you get done with that, we jumped right into the strike. Right away, first thing I noticed was the vastness, the openness. We just instantly started exploring, going around. My buddy Conman and Tower Life instantly found a way into that spire area that has the vault of glass door. I mean, within seconds, that's the first place he went, found a way inside. It was tough at first because, you know, we've been playing Destiny 1 and then we come into this game and it feels completely different, and all we know is Destiny 1 movement and ability spam and all this stuff, and I'm sure we'll get into that a little bit later. But yeah, it definitely felt like you had to be more strategic with your ammo usage and your ability usage.
Big differences.
Like Beastly said, you get to the end of that strike, man, and that boss, he loses his head and he just starts going crazy, dude.
Yes,
he's invading your space. And it was really tough. And I'm sure we'll get into this a little bit, but yeah, PvP felt great. I'm really excited. Well, how about you, Gary?
Talking about that story mission, the first mission there. Aside from the cinematics that we had, did you feel it was a significant departure from the first story mission of the Taken King? Because I went back and played that just for perspective, because I heard the view expressed. And I've got to be honest, the first mission of the Taken King was pretty cinematic too, which didn't necessarily play out to the rest of the game.
This one was on a different level, in my opinion, Gary. I mean, you come in, and one of the first things you see is like this crucible robot. I can't remember what they're called, but they're like defenders of the city, right? And you see him just get torn apart by the Cabal. And like, throughout it, you start fighting next to Zavala, and then you see Ikora Ray just go ham, and you see Cade 6 just be badass with his six shooter. And, you know, like, all throughout it, it's like you're getting feels because you're seeing this place you spent so much time in getting destroyed, but you're also, for the very first time, like, Lord Shax is holding the door open for you as you go through. Like, there's so many things that are just lining up to just... It doesn't always only bring back feels, but it also, it gets you amped up for the future. And then right at the end, without kind of spoiling anything about the end of that mission, it gets me excited to play the second mission, the third mission, the fourth mission.
Exactly. Yeah. That's exactly how I felt after playing. I was like, wow, after this is the beta. This is what they're allowing us to see now. What are they going to have next? You know, what are they really cooking for the gamers? To me, those are probably the most exciting aspects of it. Actually, my wife and I played through The Strike again today, right before we started the show. And you know, for me, I've never been really the PvP gamer. The PvE in Destiny has always been the thing that's really got my blood rushing. And to see the way that they've approached this, to me, has been really exciting. And if this is a beta, this is just, you know, what they're allowing us to see. I'm sure they've got some even crazier stuff, you know, lined up down the line for us now.
So there is some weird stuff about PvE. I think a lot of it comes from, you know, we're literally in Destiny 1, we're in the Age of Triumph. We're the most powerful we've been as a Guardian in a long time. And you go into PvE in Destiny 2, and you're not that powerful Guardian, right? Is you only have access to some of your subclass skill trees. You have access to very limited weaponry. Your recharge rates are very slow for grenades and for supers, and your supers don't feel all that powerful anyway.
No, they don't.
So in PvE, it's like there's a big difference between what we know about Destiny and like this bombastic, just being super powerful Guardian fighting off hordes of aliens. And in Destiny 2, it really feels like, I think Wilson said it well, is that you really got to think about your movements. You got to be tactical in PvE and move around the map, use cover in PvE. I don't know that I like it as much. I think it'll take some time for me to adjust. It may also change a little bit as we get more powerful armor and our abilities start recharging faster. In the beta, some people are seeing that there are blue drops that are kind of randomly appearing for a very limited amount of people. And those blues are dropping at above 200 light, which is the max light level of the beta. So it would appear to me that we are going to get more powerful from where we're at in the beta, for sure. So, you know, along with more power may come, you know, faster recharge rates and more grenades and more powerful supers and stuff like that.
And greater responsibility.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Put on the mask. Now, let me ask you guys a question. You know, as someone who didn't play Destiny nearly as much as the three of the other hosts, did you guys notice that when you're playing the PvP portion of the beta, that your supers recharge much slower than they used to? I've noticed that I've only been able to recharge my super once per match.
In PvP. I gotta say, I love that, Beastly. Like, it is one of my favorite things about... Right now, if you go play PvP in Destiny 1, it is supers and grenades, and that's how people are winning matches right now.
And shotguns. Shotguns
to some extent. Going from Destiny 1 PvP to Destiny 2 PvP, where it is primary battles. Like, you're just constantly getting into primary battles. Team shots are incredibly important because...
Yes, they are.
If I get in a one-on-one with Wilson and... You know, and we start shooting at the same time, but all of a sudden Beastly comes up behind me and starts shooting Wilson too. Wilson's fucked.
It's a wrap.
Right?
That's the way team shooting go.
I can beat Wilson.
I don't know. Let's be honest, right? This is Beastly aiming at Wilson. Wilson's fine. Wilson's got shooting a wall somewhere up on the side. No problem.
I gotta say, it's gonna be really hard to clutch some rounds now. Like, it's not gonna be like D1 where, you know, I'm baiting people down the hallway and turning around and getting a quick scope off and coming in and lucking the chamber the next guy and melee this one dude, you know, the third guy to get a shield. It's going to be tough, man. Like, the team shots are real. And yeah. I don't really see a problem with that. I like that team building. I mean, Brian, you've played with me a lot. Like, it's not just a humble thing. It's just that, like, even though somebody made a great play, there's several things that happened before that everybody contributed to, right, to make absolutely said play happen. And I feel like those things will be highlighted more now, and it won't be just, oh, so-and-so got the kills. You know what I mean? Like, so I'm pretty excited about that.
I feel exactly what you're saying there, Wilson. It's like Destiny is a game that's predicated on teamwork, but usually it's just team chat and people going and doing their own thing. Right. Destiny 2 seems more predicated on actual teamwork. You know, you guys got to stay together. You got to move together. You got to focus on goals together in order to achieve. And, you know, just when we played together, I was like, wow, I'm screwed if I go off on my own. And Destiny 1, it didn't feel nearly, you know, as bad of a situation. But in Destiny 2, in this beta, anytime I was on my own, I knew that if I went around the corner, I was pretty much dead. And so I think they're really showing gamers that we need to actually stick together in Destiny 2 to work together as a team to be successful. And to me, that actually works really, really well.
What's Destiny 2 going to do for the selfish dick demographic like myself, who doesn't like working with the team? You know, one of the biggest reservations
not a team
I've
player,
got.
Well, because
one
you're a selfish dick, nobody cares.
Absolutely.
Is Gary a hunter? Is Gary a hunter?
Of course I'm a hunter.
Yeah. Then that's all you got to do is be a hunter, I mean, man. You're good. You're there.
One of the biggest reasons I don't play Overwatch, right, is because I'm dependent on my team to succeed. I can't just run around on an Overwatch map and stomp everyone, because there's counterplay, and you know, if there's a heal supported Roadhog, I'm doing shit to him. You know, I'm just not going to hurt him. That's what I used to like about Destiny 1, is that I could go and drop like a 30 bomb game and I could just stomp all over people, no problems, and have fun. And I didn't care, you know, if I baited my team and I spawn flipped and got them killed, great, because at least I know where the enemy are and I can push in. In this game, I can't do that anymore. I need players. And it's really frustrating.
I think you got to find your legs a little bit. I think once, like, this is a very small slice of what we're getting. We have a very limited weapon options for weapons, archetypes, things. Maybe there's going to be armor pieces that may affect abilities and stuff like that. We don't other skill trees. So I mean, I'd hang in there. I mean, I still think once everybody gets their legs, their D2 legs, and they know their way around and they have their movement capabilities as good as they can be, I think you're going to start seeing a lot of clutches and 1v2s, maybe 1v3s if, you know, the team's done. People already, I mean, even in Destiny 1 in Trials, they'll come at me 1v1, you know, when there's three of them alive and they just force a 1v1, you know, so I imagine people will do it in this game too. So
yeah, they will.
You know?
They certainly will. I noticed that the competition was easing up as the weekend went on, too. Once the beta became open, I felt like my games were getting easier. At the beginning, it was very much a hard... Well, at the very beginning, skill-based matchmaking hadn't taken effect yet. So my first game was ridiculously easy. But by the third or fourth game, you know, skill-based matchmaking caught up, and all of a sudden it was like, okay, I'm fighting for every kill. I got to be very careful about going around corners. Because if there's two guys over there, they're gonna team shot me right away.
Yep.
But I also noticed that even if there were two guys over there, I could peek around that corner, shoot one of them back up, and a lot of times one of them would come chasing me and the other one would stay behind.
Right.
I mean, there aren't, like, it's a different, there's different tactics, but there's definitely still ways to maximize an advantage, because you just have such an advantage. Like, if you know a guy's coming, you can be pre-firing, especially if you're using that sweet business or a main ingredient.
Right, and I agree with Gary. Like, I loved the, trust me, dude, I love the clutch. I love going off and, you know, just sniper headshot, just going off on people. But, like, it will be nice for some change. Hopefully it's not, like, as heavily team shot oriented as it is now. Maybe it'll get a little less once, like I said, once people kind of figure out what's going on and the, you know, meta settles in. I think
do you guys think that the change for ammo as far as heavies, snipers, shotguns, the fact that you got to work so much harder to get that ammunition is going to change the PvP, the dynamic that exists now, and maybe turn some D1 players off?
I'll say this. It's a lot harder to get the power ammo than it is to actually use the fusion rifle. I'm just going to throw that out there. That thing is really good right now. I feel like, I think I had mentioned it to Briar one night, I feel like all the power weapons that used to be special weapons are all unnerfed versions of themselves, except the sniper. But yeah. I'm partial to snipers, so, I mean, maybe just a tiny little bit less flinch would be cool. Maybe don't overdo it, you know? I'm not looking for any, like, no flinch beyond.
Gotcha.
Type stuff, but maybe just a little bit. But then again, there's other snipers out there, so we don't know, like, what.
I agree with you there, Wilson, because now that it's not going to be just, you know, six men on each team just using snipers as primaries, like, you know, we had that meta at one point. Now that it's one or two guys that have a sniper, you know, let them be powerful. Let them be as powerful as that main ingredient fusion rifle. You know, let the shotgun be powerful. Let everything be powerful. limit the power via the ammo, limit the power via how fast that there ammo spawns in.
You know, I like that.
But don't limit the power that, you know, this gun is impossible to use when all you got to do is get close to somebody with a different weapon.
Yeah, I can tell you the fusion rifle is a game changer right now. If you both pull power, you're down on points. Gary knows.
And that fusion is just an I win button. It's so easy. I was screaming it. Screaming at Briar the whole time we were playing. He was like, shut up about it. Shut up about the fusion.
Me too. Me too.
Every time I got it, I'd start giggling.
Yeah, he was a madman. I got a collat with it, one fusion shot, two kills, and I go, balanced. And Briar goes, you shut your mouth.
I was in the game, and I was knocking my ass off, too. I actually got the fusion today, too, and it really is something special.
It was PvP, one of my favorite things about Destiny 1. Like, vanilla Destiny 1, fusion rifles were awesome, and they were a weapon that you just didn't see in other games, so it really felt like something new and original in Destiny. And then they got nerfed, and they've never really been the same. You can get a Saladin's Vigil now that is kind of good. It can be good, but it doesn't feel as good as they used to in Destiny 1. And now having it be a really awesome weapon, it's a fun way to play the game that you don't find that gun in Call of Duty or Battlefield, right?
Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah, absolutely.
So I really have always enjoyed fusions, and it's been sad for me that they've kind of been so crappy so long.
What do you think the chances are? I'm sorry, Gary. Go ahead.
I was going to say another gun you don't see in many other games. You do see it in some things like McCree in Overwatch, but the hand cannon was always a sort of watermark of Destiny. Like the hand cannon was, you know, if you went into the Crucible, you used a hand cannon. What do you feel like about the relegation of hand cannons to pretty much the sidearm role now, where if you're at range, you're not going to use a hand cannon, and even up close, an SMG does its job better?
I wouldn't be surprised if it feels different in the full release of the game, because hand cannons did not feel like that when I played the DRE in LA.
Right.
Really?
Yeah, it didn't. Like, I was using the Sunshot in the DRE, and it felt like a Destiny 1 hand cannon, but with less range. In the beta build, there's something weird about aiming all the guns, I think. There's less aim assist than we're used to in Destiny 1 for sure. And hand cannons, since you're using them at close range, you really need to be hitting headshots, although they're kind of four-shot kills no matter where you hit them now. There's something different about it, and I'm not so sure that it won't get reverted back, because I don't think it was a positive change what we saw in the beta as compared to the DRE. It felt different, and it felt worse in a way.
Now, what hand cannon were you guys using? Were you guys using the Better Devils or the Minuet, the Solar Burn one?
Mainly the Minuet, because the Nightshade is filthy as a primary.
I didn't like the explosive rounds on the Better Devils for some reason. That explosion going on messes with my view, or like my aim assist or something.
It's hard to see. It's hard to target acquire for that second shot.
At least that's what it feels like for me. With the Minuet, if I let, and it was kind of hard sometimes, you didn't always have the option to, but if I let that recoil settle, I did not miss a shot. With that hand cannon.
I didn't want to go that deep on it, but I felt like initial accuracy is strong, especially with the buff that you get on the Minuet for the first shot. But follow-up shots, the bloom, the reticle settle, seems to be a lot longer than it was in Destiny 1. So I just wonder whether or not, and again, like you say, in those firefights, you don't have the opportunity to let the reticle settle because someone's spraying a pulse at you at max rate of fire or fully auto with the purple Nurple. So, you know, it really is not a good place to be for hand cannons. I was using the Nightshade and the Phosphorus SMG. Mm-hmm. And I found still, actually, once I got my head around it, the best way to play the game to have the most fun was to play like Destiny 1. And you just use the one shot maybe from the pulse, push someone with an SMG and just punch them. Just get near them and punch. I mean, Brian was watching the kill feed. Like, most of my kills were just punches. Punch, you know, SMG punch, SMG punch.
Let me
ask you guys a question. You guys have had a pretty extensive playtime with this beta at this point. After playing through the story mode and playing through the PvP, what are you guys more excited for? I mean, as far as the changes that have been made, are you guys more excited for what they've done with the PvP, or are you guys more excited for the story mode?
I'll go first. I'm much more excited for PvP than from what I've seen out of story mode so far for PvE. Sure. For PvE, I've got big concerns for this game. And I've had big concerns like from the get-go, like when they started talking about it. My concerns for PvE aren't just like we're getting supers less frequently frequently, but how are they going to do content in the future? Are we going to get Destiny 2 and then have to wait a year for more content? I don't think so, but are they going to be able to keep up with player demand for more content? Are we going to go through the storyline in 8 hours, 15 hours, and be done?
Done?
Like, that's my concern for Destiny 2's PvE. I think the balancing stuff, that'll get figured out. Maybe it launches a little screwy, and they fix it in the first patch or the second patch or with the Osiris DLC come winter. I'm not really that concerned about it. I think they'll fix it. But I'm concerned about content delivery, how fun the game is, and how long it lasts. Because
how many hours would be adequate, Briar, do you think? If you had 30 hours, do you think that would be adequate, or 40 hours?
No, I think there should be hundreds of hours.
I mean, at launch, I'm talking about.
At launch. I'm saying at launch. I mean, yeah, the story will take, 8 to 15 hours, right? Just running through the story. Yeah. That'll be short. But then after you've done the story, like going through and collecting weapons, collecting armor, getting raid ready, running strikes, lost sectors on patrol, all the cool stuff on patrol. I want to see missions come up on a random Tuesday in the middle of October, and it pops up on Reddit and said, yeah. Oh my God, there's this awesome exotic. Everybody's got to run this mission this certain way. Like stuff we saw in The Taken King. Like that's the kind of stuff that we've seen in the past from Destiny, but we haven't seen lately that I'm really hoping we see again, because that's what keeps me coming back day to day and being super excited about it. I love that. That side of PvE is so much fun. So that's what I'm really concerned about, is not going to be there. I'm hoping that I'm wrong about it. I'm not wrong, but I'm hoping that
Speaking of hoping, I'm hoping to be with you guys for the next year in Destiny 2. So
nice.
That's a big announcement for the Beastly Gamer.
Well, you got to start by buying a PC if you want to be with us. So just take that first step.
You got to October.
There we go. How far into it? Gary's already PC. How far in are we?
I'm PC. We're what? 30 minutes in?
I've got to be honest. The aiming of that game, I use a Zim. So I'm cabled to mouse and console anyway.
I am excited for the fidelity for it for PC.
Yeah.
Are you guys having issues playing on PS4?
No. I play on a 4K TV on my PS4 Pro, and I got to say the game looks fantastic.
Same here. What are you talking about, Gary?
I think we were talking about frame rate.
He's got us
I'm
there.
The handicap. I can't use a controller properly. I can't aim with it. I've been cabled and mouse for like 16 years, 17 years of my gaming life.
Sounds like you hurt yourself a long time ago, Gary. I'm sorry, man.
Man, I'm kind of doing a two-hand job with one, really. I should be getting a medal for effort.
You always turn shit around, don't you, Gary? That's
right. Yeah, I do. For me, I liked what I saw. And I was saying before the show, with no disrespect meant to the console players, I think the game felt about as good as it possibly could for a console game.
If I wasn't
a PC player, I'd be incredibly happy with the quality of the game for the PlayStation. But being a PC gamer, it isn't what I would spend another 2,000 hours on now that I've got the option not to.
Totally respectable. And let me just say this, right? I'm actually in that space of doing research to get me a really nice gaming PC. But playing this on the PS4.
Laptop, or did we switch over to desktop?
I saw the new Asus Zephyr. It has a 1080 in it, Briar,
a 1080 that runs like a 1070.
Yep.
No. Well, look. I'll probably end up getting
the only thing 1080 desktop. About that thing is the price.
Are you a traveling salesman or something? Why do you need a portable thing? Do you got to set it up in your desk? Like,
yeah.
How many places are you playing this PC?
You've got a laptop currently, correct?
Yeah, I'm all okay. Right now.
Next thing should be a desktop, man.
You know what, Wilson? You're absolutely right. Wilson convinced me. Fuck you.
There you go.
Fuck both of you guys. Thank you,
any closing really thoughts on Destiny 2? Does anyone else want to close out?
It seems really fun, and the amount of time I played with it so far, I just can't wait to play more of it, and it's looking like it could be a whole year for me, man.
They did extend the beta till Tuesday, so you got more time to play it.
Nice. Yeah.
And then PC beta is coming in August. I can't wait for that.
Mm. All right. Well, hopefully I'll have my PC can run it, so.
I wonder how much stuff will be different.
Have
in
a PC,
that
you got a laptop.
Build.
Stop making that assumption, man.
Yeah, I wonder how much stuff will be different in the PC build, like mechanical wise, like changes that they've made in comparison to the build that we played on console.
Like in direct response to,
yeah,
like player feedback.
Possibly, or just the fact that it's being built from the ground up and it's not like a port. Like who? I mean, it's pretty exciting. It's gonna be cool. It's gonna be cool to crank that bitch on ultra settings and go into that strike and find areas to explore and get some nice high fidelity shots. It'll be great.
It's gonna be awesome to crank it to low settings and run it at 240 hertz.
I knew you were gonna say that. Slow pitch that one to you.
It's gonna be like Destiny Minecraft edition. It's
slow
gonna be
pitch.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So good. So right? good.
Hey, no, you know what, guys? Side note: I'm really surprised that the Xbox One X can't play this thing at 60 frames. I really wish it could.
I don't think it's a limitation of the Xbox One X. I think it's a limitation of the Xbox One.
Really, I think they can do it. They're just not doing it because people would lose their shit if there was a console that could do 60 and another one couldn't. I think they just weren't allowed to.
I don't know. Opinion.
I'd lose my mind.
Maybe
I'd lose my mind.
Maybe I think a lot of the frame rate too is tied directly to the processor, which isn't a big upgrade over the Xbox One.
Good point.
I think it's just because Phil cares too much.
Phil cares too. Thanks, Phil.
No, more teraflops.
Guys, don't forget that if you want to add to this topic or any other topic we discuss tonight, we'll be taking viewer feedback and discussing it at the beginning of every show. You can send feedback to revolvergamescast@gmail.com. Or you can hit us up on Twitter if it's just a brief one. The Twitter is I forgot.
Also, while Brian looks that up, if you have any nudes, we're not asking for them.
Nudes,
but if you have them and you're emailing us anyway,
I thought he said news.
No nudes or news. News is good too, but mainly nudes.
Mainly nudes.
Gary, you want to introduce the next topic because I love this topic.
Go for it. Actually, as a Twitch broadcaster, this one slaps you right in the face like a wet fish. I'm going to make the statement that what you do is not important in the slightest to gaming. Twitch. We are all in the Twitch community, be it casters or viewers or just general commenters, chat lurkers. I guess everyone here in the chat, you're all part of the problem. You're all in Twitch daily. But how much do we actually influence the gaming market? I've heard people say time and time again, yo, you know, why don't they spend more time addressing their Twitch influencers? You don't know how much we sell copies of your game. We do this, we do that. I've heard that mentioned so many times by broadcasters. But if you actually look at currently what Twitch averages and has averaged for the last 12 months, you're looking at about 650,000 concurrent users daily, of which 150,000 are sitting in League of Legends. That's only 500,000 players dispersed across all the outside players. 500,000 viewers dispersed across all the other games
just
around.
I just want to ask about that set. 650 concurrent viewers. That's 650 that are on the platform at any given time.
Any given time in a 24-hour period.
So, but how many is it for the full 24-hour period? Like the total amount of users for the full 24-hour period?
Twitch claim that there's around 10.5 million daily average users. Now, is it a daily average user if someone clicks onto it, has a look at someone and clicks off? You know, I think that stat is provided by Twitch. That's not from a third-party marketing site. So that 10.5 million seems incredibly inflated, and I'd love to dig into it, but unfortunately I can't. The figures that I do have from an independent market researcher is that you've got, let's say, about 500,000 across all games. If you look at the top 100 games sold in 2016, just the boxes alone, you got 186 million box sales. Right, across all of these 100 games. Destiny 1, which was arguably still in the top 10 relevancy on Twitch right the way through 2016 to 17, was not even in the top 100 games sold with the complete edition for 2016.
Really?
So in terms of it wasn't in the top 100 games sold. I went and looked through all the box sales.
Interesting.
Group. Yeah, but what year did it come out?
2014, but then the complete edition came out 2016.
For 2016, though, I mean, that's a two-year-old game. It came out in 2014, then it had been available for 2015, and we're looking at the 2016 stats.
But in 2016, with Rise of Iron, was when the complete edition came out, which was a new box sale. And you think, would that be in the top 100 games sold? I'm just using Destiny as an example because it retained relevancy on Twitch and wasn't generating sales, mm-hmm. regardless of if it's new or old. So the point I'd like to get into is with new games selling, you know, somewhere in the region of 2 to 4 million in their first year, and games like, you know, FIFA selling 11 million, Pokemon Sun and Moon at 14 million box sales, how much does a directory like Destiny's, which even at its peak had like, what, 8,000, 10,000 viewers in it, really do for the gaming industry? Is Twitch important, or are we just too close to it to see how insignificant it is? You know, things look really big close up, but you move back and, you know, well, it wasn't that big at all. At least that's what women tell me, but, you know, carry on.
Well, I've never heard that, but look, let me just say this. I think Twitch is important to game sales. There's a lot of games out there that people buy just based on Twitch alone, like PUBG. Briar, you saw that on Twitch, didn't you?
Yep.
You know, and word of mouth spread to us, and that's you introduced it to me, and I bought it. A lot of people see tons of games on Twitch, and they go out and buy them because they look fun. And whether or not that shows in the stats that you just, you know, presented to the audience, I think that Twitch is a huge, huge demographic of moving cartridges or CDs or whatever we're selling nowadays. People see games, they want to buy them. And for me, if I see a game that looks fun, I'm going to pick it up. You know, I watched some trailers on Superhot. I saw the game on Twitch. I didn't really understand it. Briar explained to me what was going on. And after he explained to me, I watched it a little bit more. I was like, wow, this is really amazing. It came out on PSVR. I bought it yesterday. Unbelievable. And that's because I was able to, you know, kind of see what the game was really about. And for a lot of people, that's their go-to place to find out if a game is actually good for them. And I don't think it really affects every gamer out there, but there's tons of people who watch Twitch just to find out if there's a game out there that they need to buy.
So Gary, you were just talking to me yesterday about Fortnite. And my first reaction was, I'm going to go on Twitch. Who's streaming this thing? Let's see what this thing is.
Yeah.
But I'd say you are one of the 500,000 people that are in that microcosm. So the other thing that I counter both your points with is the biggest gaming demographic on the market is mobile gamers, which in 2016-17 made up 51% of the market. So
I feel, Gary, I hear your point here, but I feel like you're picking stats that support your argument because, yeah, I definitely understand why Destiny wasn't in the top 100 retail game sales of 2016, especially when they sold like probably 90% as digital copies as an upgrade, right? Mm-hmm. You didn't go out and buy the full box copy of Rise of Iron like Super Edition. You just downloaded. Yeah, you just downloaded the Rise of Iron DLC because you already own the rest of the content. So that not being in the top 100 doesn't surprise me at all. I'd be surprised if it was in the top 1,000.
Yeah,
650,000 concurrent viewers, right? Imagine if you're Call of Duty, maybe that's not making a huge dent for you. But if you are a small developer, if you're developing a game that you're not so sure if even is going to take off, you're not so sure that people are gonna even look at. I get emails every day. Come play this game. Check out this game. We'll give you a free code for this game. I'm not even a big streamer. I got 100 concurrent viewers at any point in time. Sometimes it's 60. Sometimes it's 120. I'm not a big streamer by any means. But I'm still getting those emails all the time because they know that if they can get their game up on the Twitch directory as far as the games directory goes, that's going to get it exposure. And if they can get a couple people say, oh, what's this game? And they click on it. And they see somebody streaming it and having fun, that person is more likely to go buy it.
Absolutely.
I see your point as far as like, you know, the top 100 games, but those aren't the games that I think are going to get the most benefit from Twitch, right? It's the PUBGs of the world. It's the smaller games. I just can't think of a good example.
Friday
right
the
now.
13th, stuff that's really popular on Twitch. Yep. Yeah. And it's not a great game by any stretch of the imagination, but Friday the 13th is probably in that top 100, even though it's not that much of a great game, but it's new. If Destiny came out in 2016, you wouldn't be having this argument about Destiny. Destiny's an older game, and it's really hard to make that argument for a game that people have been playing for two and a half years.
But also, that's not Twitch's primary function is not to sell games, right? It's Twitch's primary function is entertainment. So 600 or 11 million daily users coming to Twitch to check it out. If half of them watch, you know, 20 minutes of broadcasting and get some entertainment, that's Twitch's function, not to sell video games.
Right.
Absolutely.
And that's where the, I guess, the hidden point in this message or point comes in there, Brian. I think you've uncovered it. Twitch is not important to gaming. Twitch is important to entertainment, and Twitch is important to Twitch. And I'd completely go with you on that one. From my perspective there, like you say, Twitch is out to generate revenue for Twitch. Twitch is not out to sell games copies. Twitch is not out to do anything else unless, as a, I guess, a side effect of that, it generates revenue for Twitch there. My perspective on it is then, are people, games publishers and things, trying to use Twitch for something that it's never meant to be used for? You know, a lot of the stuff that, that Twitch plays, are three out of four of the most watched games on Twitch are free to play. So they're not games that people will go out and buy box copies
free to play,
for anyway.
But they still make money.
Well, microtransactions within it, you know, loot crates or, you know, purchasing other things in there. But you're not going to sell box copies of that game there. It's something that the streamer plays because it's entertaining or it, you know, it fits their...
They're also not going to show up in a top 100 box sales.
Absolutely.
That as well.
That's true. I mean, speaking from personal experience, like, generally when you go to someone's stream and it's someone, like a stream that you frequent really often, it's somebody that you connect with and have similar views on, like, you know, gaming and stuff. And I personally have bought games based on my favorite streamers.
The streamer.
Sure. PUBG was one of them. I mean, Mr. Moon was playing it, and him and his hilarious group just made it look so funny and so much fun. And, you know, like, it just got so much exposure. And, like, Beasley, you had mentioned Friday the 13th. And even though it's kind of a dead game right now, Conan, I mean, it was the same thing. You know, Mr. Moon and all his guys were playing Conan. They were role-playing it. And I've, even though Grand Theft Auto 5 is old as hell.
Super,
I mean,
old.
I've bought that game. I bought that game three times, I think, on all consoles and PC. Just because of the streaming aspect of that game. Like, people are, they're not even playing GTA. They're it's a server mod where they're role-playing. Yeah. And there's, like, cops, and, yeah, it's crazy.
Breyer told me about PUBG probably about 2 months ago. And, you know, sometimes I'm so busy, it's really hard for me to catch up with a stream. But I watched his stream, and I watched him playing PUBG. And I was like, this shit is fucking amazing. This is something I have to play. And so I went and bought it that same night, and Twitch played a big part in that. And I know it probably wasn't Twitch's their goal to sell me a game. Of course, it's their goal to make money, just like Chick-fil-A's goal is to make money. But there are hungry people out there who rather have a chicken sandwich than a steak. And so you go to Twitch for what you need to go to it for. And when I saw Breyer playing PUBG, I was like, wow, I've never seen anything like this. This is just insane and intense action. It lasts for about 25 minutes. If you can hang in, I need to play this. And I wouldn't have gotten that experience anywhere else. So
when I play that game, because I mainly have a Destiny-focused audience on my Twitch channel, so when I play that game, like, the number one comment I see is this game available on consoles? And if so, when?
You know, like, people, I feel you guys. I feel
hungry,
you.
Hungry.
I think you nailed it, though, when you said that this helps out, like, the smaller guys, not the big conglomerates. Not Rockstar is not going to have any problem selling their next game. Call of Duty is not going to have any problem selling their next game. Like, yeah. It's like, it's a huge avenue to get people playing your game and get people talking about it. And it's like, when I hear about a game, same thing, Gary, Fortnite, when you guys getting it, did the same thing, jumped right on Twitch. You know, it's exactly how you find out what's going on with the game. It's really cool versus, man, back in our day, having to just look at a few pictures in a magazine, maybe a commercial with about 2 seconds of gameplay.
Gameplay, yes. So right, Wilson.
Right. And like, in that old model, like, how does a game like Fortnite, how do you express what that game is in, like, a series of screenshots, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and like a blurb that's, like, you know, Twitter length.
Right.
What you do is you have a screenshot of the game in small in the corner, and then you show two kids laughing, holding controllers, pointing at the screen, and cheering.
It used to work.
The Wii approach to marketing.
And that works.
It does work, Gary. I swear it works, man.
Go to a roof party and bring Mario with you. People will love it.
Yeah, I like the old Nintendo commercial where the house, like the kid had so much fun that the house just couldn't handle all the excitement and blasted off into space.
That's what you need.
You remember that, Wilson?
I do remember those. I remember all those commercials, man. Take me back, man. They were so good. That's how you sell shit. Make the house go to space.
So we've got tips there, Brian, for you to improve your stream. What you need to do is flip the face cam and the game cam around. So we just need this little tiny Destiny in the bottom right-hand corner. You know,
honestly, the smaller I make the image of Destiny, the better it'll look like I'm doing. Really, I mean, it's perfect, really.
You got a great point, Brian.
Nobody can tell that I'm getting my ass kicked. They're like, what is that down in the corner?
All you new streamers, write this down. This is pro tips right here.
I'm doing trials carries in a post-it stamp. I swear, I promise. I mean,
to be fair, streams like that already exist, but normally the streamer has like ridiculous cleavage hanging out. So
I can arrange that.
Yeah.
That's what you need, Brian.
You go shopping for halter tops tomorrow.
Step for the D2 launch.
Well, we're lucky in Butt Wipe. We're down in Florida looking for male rompers. Did you see that? No, did you see that live stream? They were trying on male rompers. Well, I mean, female rompers, but like.
Yeah. Welcome to episode 1 of Revolver, guys. Episode 1. Jesus Christ.
Well, you've convinced me, Briar. What you do is not a complete waste of time. I'll continue watching you and subscribing.
I think I'm going to quit. You convinced me the other way. I'm quitting tomorrow. I'll go get a job as an accountant. My true passion.
I thought that was male waxing. We had this discussion before.
That's my hobby. You don't want to ruin a hobby. You know, you don't want to turn a hobby into a profession.
You don't want a hobby to become a job. It loses its luster.
It's true, but the way you did it, it didn't tear at all. It didn't pull. It came off smooth. You know, the leg just...
Got magic fingers.
It's because of the passion. You got to allow the man his passion. You know? Sometimes if a person he didn't like, he'd rip that shit off. Just let him be. Let him be.
All right. Next topic. All right,
so... The
next
topic,
shot out of the chamber.
Wilson.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the SNES Classic, and there's a lot of people asking, you know, is it a good value? They brought the price to $80, and a lot of people are concerned whether or not that's going to be a good value or not. And I mean, I'm here to tell you right now, like you're saving a lot, it's a great value. It's a plug-in. I mean, it's portable. You could take it. You can move around with it. But most importantly is that if you were to buy all these games on the virtual console, you know, they're $8 a pop. You know what I mean? Like, so that would be $168, you know? So you're already paying double right there just for getting them on the virtual console. If you were to buy, like, the actual physical Super Nintendo, an extra controller, all the hookups and the cartridges for these games, you're looking at over $800, you know, for this stuff. You know, I mean,
$100.
$800.
To like go out and shop like retail price for used cartridges?
Correct. You could spend, you know, a year doing flea markets, garage sales, asking people, hey, you got any old video games? And you could come across these for a few bucks a piece. You could come across.
You gotta be very lucky to do that though, Wilson.
You do. And I can attest to that. I mean, some days are good, some days are bad. But I mean, you look at, you know, which I was kind of surprised that this game was on here. It was a cult classic when it first came out. But Earthbound is $150 to $200 for a loose cartridge. Yeah. Cartridge only. You know, we're not, these aren't complete in box prices, you know, like Contra 3 is $40 game. You know, same thing with, you know, the Final Fantasies and Mega Man X and Secret of Mana's, you know, those are $40-$50 games. And, you know, you do run the risk of, you know, the cartridge not working. I mean, let's be real, a lot of these cartridges still do work, but like I have come across, you know, one in a couple hundred that just don't want to boot up.
If you guys get a Super Nintendo cartridge, it doesn't work.
It actually has been confirmed to actually break the cartridge more than help it.
God damn it, Briar, you just killed it.
So what's going on with that, Beastly, is sometimes when you blow into a cartridge, you can't control if you're spitting into it, and spit is naturally acidic. So when it's getting on those contact points in there, you could be technically ruining them, but hey, you do you, Boo. You know, if you want, that's how you want to.
Beastly,
that's how you want to blow him up. You go right ahead.
If Beastly comes back and his dick's out, I'm hanging up. I'm just saying.
But like, what I was, you know, something else to note here is that Nintendo did a way better job with releasing the SNES Classic than they did the NES Classic. One being that there's an extra controller that's included with it. Because if you guys remember, with the NES Classic, the extra controller was sold separately, and they were scalping it in upwards to $50 for that. You know, people were buying them up and scalping them on eBay and Craigslist. And another good thing, too, is that they announced that the SNES Classic will be a limited release beforehand, whereas with the Nintendo, with the NES Classic, they just kind of announced one day, like, hey, we never really had any intention for this item to be sold permanently. It was always meant to be limited, but they had never specified that to begin with. So I'm pretty happy about that. So people know that if you're going to want to get one, you got to pre-order one. And they've actually been taking down on eBay. This is actually just recently, since people across the pond are able to pre-order already. They're sticking them up, their pre-orders on eBay. And eBay has a new policy that if you don't have the item within 30 days of it being sold,
they take it down.
And take it down. So all these are being taken down. I don't know if they'll be able to control that influx once pre-orders hit the States here. But, I mean, what do you guys think? I mean, we could go through the list of games here. I mean, it's a lot of games, but, I mean, what do you guys think about this? Good deal? Not a good deal? Is there anything
it's
you'd
an
like to see on?
Deal. It's an amazing deal. I mean, I'm 37. And so for me, in looking at this game list, the list that's on there, including the unreleased Star Fox 2, you're going to pay hundreds of dollars for these games if you went out and bought the cartridges. And like you said, you run the risk of not actually having a cartridge that works.
Yeah.
To actually have this in a certified Nintendo kind of package, you know, this is actually sanctioned by Nintendo, Super Nintendo Mini. It's got the actual controllers. I mean, you're paying $80. If you can get it, man, get it now. I mean, I've been looking for this thing for a long time. Unfortunately, one of the hosts of Revolver actually already pre-ordered one. Gary. Hey, Gary.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Gary.
God damn it.
I heard he put it on eBay.
Yeah, so pretty sweet. I check my Amazon every day to have a look at that little sweet pre-order there. I told you, didn't I? They actually emailed me.
Does it make your day go better, Gary? Does it, make it?
It was great. They emailed me and told me that they had news about my pre-order. And they actually told me they were taking another $20 off of it because the price reduced to what their initial
sack
listing
was. I love
can't.
The old
I'm looking
shirts.
For the mute button sack right now, guys. Shirt. I can't find it. How do you hang up with somebody?
You know what the funny thing is? I hate retro games. I won't even play the thing. I just wanted to have it because I know people want it.
Really?
Wow.
Really?
You,
like your wife.
You are an elitist. You really are a
I hate her
elitist.
Too, man, don't
I just proved it.
Damn.
You know,
I kind of feel similar to Gary, though. Like, if I saw this, if I was walking through a store and I saw this thing, there's no way I'm not picking it up, right? Because it's just, like, I know what I'm going to get the next. I'm going to go home, I'm going to hook it up to my TV, and for 2 hours, I'm going to enjoy, you know, dumping around in a bunch of these old games. You know, and maybe I'll check out Star Fox 2, because I've never been able to play, like, a real version of that. But I know that in 6 months, it's going to be sitting in my closet. I'm never going to pull it out again, just like, you know, a bunch of stuff that's in there. If I go out and buy the games that I actually know I want to play on the virtual console, assuming it ever comes to the Switch,
it better.
I'm much more likely to play it on the Switch because I could just grab that thing. You know, I could play it on a plane. I could play it in the back of a cab. And yeah, it's not as good a value, but half the games on that list I'm never going to really play much of anyway. So I fully admit that if I see this thing sitting on a store shelf, I'm absolutely going to buy it because, you know, I'm wasteful with money. But
so am I, man.
Like, it's to me, it's not actually a good value because I'm not actually going to use it that much.
Yeah,
fair enough.
I mean, the games look great, though. I mean,
they do.
In terms of, do I know the titles? Yes. Are they good games? Probably. Will I play them? No. Will I own it? Yes. So there you go. That's my little list of everything.
I can tell you right now, all the titles on here I've played, and there's maybe one that you can skip, and that's Super Punch Out.
Thank
I know some people
so
probably, some people might probably not agree with that, but I mean, I feel like they really knocked it out of the park with these
titles.
Because
if
you look at the NES Classic, I feel like the NES Classic was more pick up and play type games. These are more meaty games that have story to them, you know? Mario RPG, Super Metroid, you know, Super Castlevania.
Isn't
like,
Chrono Trigger on there too?
It is not.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah,
Super Castlevania 4 is amazing, though.
That's an expensive game, Chrono Trigger. But yeah, I mean, a lot of these games, you know, and you also another thing too, like buying these online, you never know what you're going to get sometimes. I mean, you're not going to find a counterfeit Star Fox 1 because they're like coasters and it's not worth people's time to burn the ROM chip for a $15 game. But like something like Earthbound, that's $150, $200. You know, you would have to contact the seller and have them take a picture of the cartridge opened up so you can see that the ROM chips are original and they're not running any like dip switches or, you know, wires to different
contacts. That's where the value comes in. The value comes in there when you know it's actually sanctioned by Nintendo and they're putting it, the ROM on this little system for you. It just makes
all the system
work.
It's emulated, right? It's an emulated system.
It's perfectly emulated, though. They emulate it to the same degree of the cartridge. So it's just
the exact same. That wasn't true of the NES Classic.
I think one or two games they had issues.
Oh, man. I think you got called out by your buddies at Digital Foundry. They did a little bit of work on it. You just got smacked by your mama there. That was it. Digital Foundry just came straight in. Your boy just called you out.
Well, look, I told you guys before we did, you know, started the show today that when I was in Ohio on my vacation last week, I stopped by my favorite store. It's called the Exchange. It used to be called the Record Exchange, and they had this thing. It's called the Yobo.
Jesus Christ. He's got it out.
Oh, stop it, Gary. What this thing is?
This is not an approved topic. I just want to make a note. I want to adjust the amendments of the show notes that this is not an approved topic.
Stop talking, Briar. This thing
we have
here.
More to say about
fake Vita.
And then he brings that monstrosity
Vita.
Fake Vita. That's what Gary said. That's what Gary called it earlier.
This is a portable SNES, okay?
And it looks like a DS with something hanging off the edge.
Who's it's called a Super Nintendo cartridge, right?
Who's it made by? What Chinese factory has been producing that shit?
But the
I think your
thing
toast
is
done.
Let's just pull it out, shall we? Look, this thing is so cool. And, you know, I used to shop this place all the time when I lived in this state. But it's a portable Super Nintendo that also has an audio video port. So you can plug it into the TV. It has two wireless controllers, Super Nintendo controllers, and it's just so cool. And the thing that really bothered me is I was looking for the Super Nintendo Mini, and I was looking for it from the day that Gary pre-ordered his. You bastard. I love you, Gary.
You know what's and good so, about that little handheld is how thin and sleek it looks as well. It's impressive.
You can see it. It's so
thin. Is that thing designed by Apple in California? Because, I mean, it's just gorgeous.
I have very, very, very thin hands. My hands are like pizzelles. Look at this thing.
It's about as thin as a Bible.
God damn it. Let's go to the next topic.
Finish with the SNES. Jesus Christ. What do you guys think? Inner Black Ninja in chat, friend of the show.
Inner Black, what's up, baby?
Made a good point about the SNES, though. Are you guys excited about it coming out or just super bummed that Nintendo are making you buy something else instead of a virtual console on the Switch that has these games?
That's a great...
I don't own a Switch, but I'll tell you right now, I would rather have a virtual console on the Switch than the SNES Mini, because that would be more of a reason for me to make the jump and get the Switch.
I agree with Wilson. I'd rather be able to buy, you know, Super Mario World and play it on my couch or play it on the plane or play it in bed, not be tied to a console with a 3-foot controller cable.
Is the Super Nintendo Mini's cords really that short?
No, they're six. They've given you six.
They're longer than they were for the NES.
Stretch your legs out this time. I 100% agree with you, Wilson. And Inner Black Ninja, you know what it is. You know what it is. Old school gamer like me, I think it's unfortunate that Nintendo hasn't put the virtual console on the Switch. I bought mine day one.
Is it coming?
It has to. Look, they haven't moved forward this much. With the Wii and the Wii U, with this whole thing, to completely just let it die. It makes no sense.
There's been no confirmation of a virtual console, but Nintendo have said that the Nintendo Game Pass is going to be different. So rather than one game that you get for the month, it's going to be like a Netflix-style access. So they'll give you a library of games that you can play. Then that library will rotate at a set time, same as Netflix, you know, get some new shows, get rid of some old shows. So you'll have access to a library of games, but not necessarily whether or not you can buy specific ones. I don't know.
That's maybe. Pretty cool, actually. That's almost better. If the one thing, I believe they said that they wouldn't be taking games away. They'd only add over time, right?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think originally they had said that the games would rotate out, and then there's a lot of controversy about it, so Nintendo kind of changed their mind and said they wouldn't rotate games out. They would just keep adding to it. I think that's what they said, but it was a long time ago now.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm looking at our notes that Wilson actually created. And wow, Wilson, when it comes to the games that are actually on the Super Nintendo Mini, these games cost a ton of money compared to what you're going to spend just for this thing. And for me, I can't even understand a person saying that it's not a great value, because we're looking at $300 at least just for the games, or you just to buy the games without a console.
Oh, over that. I mean,
it's insane how much money you save.
It's not the value, it's the opportunity. Opportunity cost to my time. Like, I've got this great little thing, but I've got to go over to the TV. I've got to plug it in. I've got to get something out. I've got to whereas, you know, for me, a lot of the time, I don't like to play something if it's not on Steam. Do you know what I mean? Like, just, I'm that lazy. Like, I like to
he
just
doesn't even like
play.
Switching the input on his monitor. He's like, nah, he's an elitist. I don't want to play that.
True story, right?
He wants Netflix. I'd have to reach all the way behind Steam there and hit that menu button.
True story on what Bryce said. I've got a 4K monitor sitting there on the right of me. I've got a 1080p monitor on the left of me and a 1440p in front of me. I'm playing Destiny in 1080p on a 1440p monitor. You know, the Destiny 2, sorry. It's out of focus. It looks terrible because I'm too lazy to switch the monitors either to my left or right.
Wow, in 4K or in native resolution 1080p, but he's playing in the middle 1440p.
Nah, fuck it.
That's what laziness does to you, man. That's why, for me, the SNES Classic, as great as it is, I agree, it's great value. I'm buying it because it's chibi and cute. I'm never going to use it.
I am looking at the price list that you put in here, and you got Super Ghouls and Ghosts for $25. I'm going to say that I would pay somebody $25 to not play that game.
That's
first one, man. The second one's way better than the first one, man. The one on the NES was way harder than the one on Super Nintendo, in my personal opinion. Especially since when you beat the game, and spoilers, nothing happens. You just start the game over again at a harder difficulty, and you don't even get an ending until you beat it again on an even harder difficulty. Like, it's brutal. But like, I could see how it would just be a nuisance to somebody. Like, it'd be more convenient for Breyer to say, like, hook his Switch up so if he wanted to stream some of those virtual console games, you know what I mean? Like, it'd be a lot easier than trying to hook a SNES Classic or, you know, Mini or an NES Classic up and stream from that, you know? So
I didn't even think about the streaming of it. Just the convenience of, like, having it on a portable. That can also, you know, I'm a huge fan of the Switch. Like, I really think it's a brilliant idea, a console, because it's a portable, like, and I can play the same game. I could be playing Breath of the Wild on a monitor, and then, you know, just grab it and go outside and sit on the hammock and play it as well. You know, like, it's a beautiful thing.
It really is. I mean, when you actually use it, I took mine to, you know, up north, and it really, when you use it, it's really, really a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
All right. So the next topic is about the console wars. I know a lot of the hosts here hate the console wars. They hate fanboy wars. And for me, watching it for the last few years, it is kind of a futile effort, but it doesn't appear, to me at least, like it's going to go anywhere. I think it's going to persist and continue for many, many years to come, unless there's a true dynamic change. And I really wanted you guys' thoughts on this. If history's any indication, the great console wars will forever be. While many cry foul of the fanboy wars, it seems that the red versus blue systems has always been here, and they will always be here. And when we look back at, like, the Super Nintendo versus Genesis, Game Boy versus Game Gear, PlayStation versus Sega Saturn and Nintendo 64, PlayStation 2 versus Xbox and GameCube, it seems like this persistent fanboyism has always existed. With the expansion of technology and the freedom of expression the internet allows gamers, it seems that many are frustrated with the nature of the console wars. And that's really, to me, something I've seen in the last 4 or 5 years. Exclusives, DLC, and timed exclusivity frustrate many. But if the past is any indication, the system of competition will always exist. Or will it? Do you guys think that this thing will always be? Do you think that there's any way that we can get rid of this fanboy war, the console war, or do you think that this will forever be the way it's going to be?
I think as long as there's always multiple options, you're always going to have people saying, you know, one side's better than the other. I'm not a big fan of console wars. I do miss the old Genesis versus Super Nintendo days, though. Some of those old ads on TV where you're just
Genesis double, Super Nintendo don't, son.
Yep. Yeah. You know,
when,
like
when the companies were actually savage against each other. Yeah. It was entertaining to watch.
That's what I'm saying. You know, it's a little gladiatorial, so to speak, but like watching two companies go at it on commercials and battling each other. But nowadays, it's like I don't mind competition. Because we as consumers benefit when there's competition.
Absolutely.
But when we are like just bickering about it, yeah, it kind of gets old. You know
what
I mean?
It's like politics almost now.
Yeah, it can almost become politics because it's like, who am I to say that somebody's not having a good time on another console?
Absolutely. You're 100% right. And that's the thing, right? To me, it is subjective. You know, I enjoy my Xbox One. I was playing my Xbox One this week. And for some people, if I say that, it's blasphemy against PlayStation and vice versa. And I know it's blasphemy for the people who know me for me to say that. But I love gaming consoles. I love video gaming in general. And for me, it seems like it's a futile gesture, a futile effort to constantly be badgering the
I think it's against human nature, Beasley. I think there's like this little part of our lizard brain like that goes way, way back.
And as he where, speaks in front of a green screen. Go
it's
ahead.
Where racism comes from, and it's where nationalism comes from. And it's like that, it's that feeling that I feel better if I'm surrounded by people who are just like me and have made the same decisions as me.
Wow.
And that shit doesn't go away. You know, it's part of it's part of what has made the human race successful, right? And it's part of what has made, you know, evolution work in our favor, but it's, I mean, I think at this point it's holding us back in like an age of reason. It holds us back because we make decisions not based on our own best interests, but based on how this little part of our lizard brain makes us feel. Right?
You're so right, man.
But there's also the aspect of buyer's remorse, right? Nobody wants to feel that. It feels shitty, right? You go out,
right?
You buy something. And you get it home, and you're really enjoying it, and your buddy comes over and says, oh, I got one, but it looks twice as good. You should have gotten that one.
It's got more teraflops.
Yeah, it costs half as much as it's got twice as many teraflops. You're like, shit, man, fuck I just you. Spent all the money. I spent all my hard-earned money on this one, and now I feel shitty. Like, that is a bad feeling. So people will actually fight that feeling.
They'll double down.
They'll double down, even if they think they made a bad decision. They'll still double down on it because they're trying to... They have an
justify
internal monologue,
purchase.
Yeah, that when they're trying to justify their purchase.
So, I mean, the issue with console wars, I guess, is that you've got two opposing manufacturers. And when you've got two opposing manufacturers, they're going to be rattling for market share. I mean, what I love about PC is that you've only got one, you know, Mac is what it is. But let's just forget about them for a moment. You've only got one platform. You know,
leave it there.
Cold.
Leave
it there. So cold. You've He's got Windows, cold as ice. You know?
All games are going to come out on Windows. Yeah, and as a Windows PC user, I can play all the games. Doesn't matter. As long as I've got capable hardware, I play them all. It's frustrating if I were a console player to have to think, I can't play Crackdown, or I can't play Sea of Thieves, or I can't play Horizon, or I can't play Yakuza. That's kind of frustrating to me. What I'd love to see is if all games were PC games, you know, and then you build I'm just saying, like, you know, all consoles just died.
I hear you.
As a console manufacturer, you had to play, let's say you're a DVD producer. You know, there is only one DVD or one Blu-ray, but Samsung make it and Hitachi make it and Sony make it, and everyone makes a machine that plays this single platform, and you buy the machine which gives the most utility to you. So I'd love to see it move to that sort of thing, that Sony and Microsoft are both making PlayStations and Xboxes that just play video games. They don't play Xbox games or PlayStation games.
That would be awesome, but I don't think they're going to do it.
Yeah.
No, obviously not. Phil's not listening to me now. I'm going, hold the press.
This is one of those conversations that'll persist until the end of time, because, you know, we've got console manufacturers who are working together with developers to develop games for that console. And games like Uncharted, The Last of Us, games like Halo, these are made in-house. And of course, they have specific tones, and they have a specific place where they're supposed to be. And I would love to see all this stuff on PC, but of course it flies against the fact that you have these hardware developers behind these games, and that just will never happen. And so with that being said, the Super Nintendo Genesis ecosystem lives on. You know,
well, you know what, I'll tell you what really drives me crazy, Beastly, is when I hear a guy who says, you know, I love this brand because this brand doesn't care about me, right? Or I love brand X because brand Y has clearly demonstrated they don't give a shit about me.
Gotcha.
Right? They don't give a shit about me. Like, you think brand X cares about you? They care about Hell you spending no. money on that. Like, it's what do you think this is? You dollar. Think they have a personal interest in your well-being? No. They have a personal interest in you spending money on their brand X. That shit drives me crazy because that is people making decisions based on like this unreal expectation that they could never, like, you are basically making a decision on just like pure bullshit at that point.
So 100%, 100%. So I'm guessing we've all come to the conclusion that the console wars will continue, and there's really nothing we can do about it. As long as there's going to be companies out there like Sony, Nintendo, and Microsoft that are going to be vying for our dollars individually and separatists from other companies, they're going to do little things and exciting things to keep us on their team. And
it doesn't just happen in consoles either. I mean,
it happens everywhere.
Yeah, you look at computers everywhere. And it's AMD Cars versus everywhere. Intel, or it's Ford versus Chevy, or it's, you know, and those, like, well, now my identity is tied to the identity of my Ford pickup truck, right? Mm-hmm. What the fuck?
You make a solid point because it's the same in the glass blowing industry with like color manufacturers or torch manufacturers. Like, are you a GTT user or do you use Bethlehem? You know, and people do identify you with the type of torch that you use. That's the funny thing too. It's the same thing as driving a vehicle.
Seriously?
Like, yeah. And like, as far as like gaming goes, like I would like to see that as well, Gary, like games unified across all platforms. And maybe not quite what you said, but just all games available. I'm not a big fan of the exclusivity of certain consoles. I think that everyone should have the opportunity to play that game. But then you also got to think about how many companies are behind the scenes, like throwing money to make these things exclusive. Because we're seeing a lot more. Well, I mean, like around the Xbox PS2 era is when we started really seeing like a lot more. Like, we always had games that were exclusive to NES or, you know, Nintendo titles or something like that. But it seems like once we got into like the disc-based games, we started seeing a lot more like you can only get this one on this console. And like, you know, things like, you know, with Destiny, with them locking out content to Xbox players for a year and stuff like that. Like, it's just, I'm not as a PlayStation main for Destiny, like, I'm not a fan of that, like, that kind of stuff.
The consoles are actually getting more and more similar, right? The hardware is getting more and more similar. So it's actually easier to port your game to PC, Xbox, and PlayStation because shit.
I think that's the direction it's going. Yeah. I think that's the direction it's going, is that eventually everything will someday become PC, like pretty close to it anyway. I really do think it is heading that direction. You still be able to use a controller, you know, but.
And when it does, we will welcome you all, no matter which peasant hovel you crawled from. You know, you're welcome.
You one sack of, you European piece of shit.
What if I came from a Vita?
Then you will get the presidential suite and a handjob.
What?
I like hand jobs.
I own two Vitas. I own two Vitas.
Vita? I do too. I actually do own two.
I got to be honest. That's on my knees with the blowy.
You're going to need some Red Bull because you got three guys coming to visit you, homie. Real talk. God damn it.
I think Beasley's got like four or five hanging around the house.
There's five Vitas here.
Your jaw's going to lock up, Gary.
You need to rest up, Gary.
I must be doing some bicep curls or something before this. Yeah.
God damn it. I'm happy we got a chance to cover that. Now, the next topic, guys, is one that's kind of unique to me, but I also wanted to talk to you guys about it and see if the way that I feel about this particular aspect of gaming is ubiquitous. You guys
see this one's tearing you up inside.
It is. You know, it's just been killing me because I'm a video game collector. I've been collecting games for a long time, and I have I have 45 video game consoles. So I have a lot of video games in this house, and I've been doing it for a very long time. And as a longtime console collector, the thought of abandoning this way of life is extremely unlikely to me. The feeling that I get when I get a ton of video games together or consoles and break out my dust collector is really amazing. You dust off your consoles and you feel good about yourself. But the question is, has the latest efforts by console makers given physical collectors a reason to ditch collecting in favor of game sharing? So this is my issue. I've been collecting games for a long time. Breyer was actually one of the first people I ever met who told me, that's going away, Beastly. You can just hang it up. And I was like, yeah, get the hell out of here. We've been having this discussion for years, Breyer. And and the thing that's really kind of hit me in the sternum is that it's really true. And the thing that actually pushed me over the precipice was not what I expected it to be. So I want to go over some of the pros and cons of game sharing. I mean, not game sharing, but digital collection over physical collection. So here are the pros of collecting physical games, at least in my mind. You get bragging rights. When people come over here and I show them my shit, they go, oh, wow, amazing. You can always own your copy of the game. So if a network goes down, you actually own that game. Tangible collection that you can put your hands on. So it's something that you'll have years down the line. Depending on the condition of the game, you can have greater value. So the game actually is worth a lot more money. Now, the pros of digital ownership are actually, to me, a little bit greater. You don't have to leave home to buy a game. That's something I've really been enjoying. You never worry about a disc being scratched or blowing out a cartridge. Or damaging a cartridge,
you
as I learned today.
All over that
God damn it, Brian.
It's never going to work again.
Better put
that's
it on
the
eBay.
Fourth time.
I brushed my teeth before I blew it. Maximizes. Look, if you buy digital games, you can maximize your living space without game cases all over the place. And I've seen many home setups with game cases everywhere. And for me, that's a huge deal when you don't have to do all that and you got 1,000 games on your PS4.
I can speak for that. That used to be me. I had a wall with bookshelves.
I've only got four, and to
me,
those
had to move,
so big.
Ugh, it was a nightmare when we had to move.
You got
to
take them all down, yeah. And another great thing is preloading a game. This is something that doesn't exist if you have a physical representation of a game. Preloads exist digitally only, as well as betas. It's something that you'll never get with a physical game. While the pros and cons make for an intriguing conversation, inter-game sharing, and this is the aspect of this conversation that I like. Game sharing allows the buyers to purchase a single digital copy of any game with the added bonus of being able to share that game with another player inside the buyer's home or across the country. So a lot of people didn't know this. A lot of people probably still don't know this if you have a PlayStation or an Xbox. Game sharing has changed the way that I game. And while I do miss the pride and glory associated with a huge collection of physical games, the added bonus of sharing the experience with my wife, who's my number one game player, she plays with me all the time, allowing she and I to simultaneously play games together was too much of a draw. Saving money, getting two copies of any game on PlayStation 4, which is my primary system, for the price of one, and the aforementioned perks of going digital have swayed me in a way I feel I cannot reverse. I hate to say that. I'd love to hear the thoughts of you guys on this topic. Is if you actually have more than one PlayStation, which I know, Breyer, you do, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
To actually buy a digital version of a game and have it on more than one system, to me, that is the perk that sent me over the edge, that pushed me completely away from buying digital physical copies of video games. Do you guys have any thoughts on this?
The first time I had to deal with this, surprise, surprise, was with Destiny. My kids wanted to play some Destiny. I wanted to play with
them. I remember.
So I went through like that kind of learning experience of like setting up your primary PlayStation,
secondary,
and figuring out how to share the games. And it's a little complicated at first, but once you get it, it's super easy because basically you buy one digital copy of the game and you can play it on any of your PlayStation. You can actually play together, which is awesome. So my primary complaint with digital purchasing was that it was costing me money because previously what I would do is I'd buy a disc-based copy, play it, and then sell it. Right? I'd either sell it back to GameStop or I'd sell it on eBay, mostly to GameStop because I'm fucking lazy. And you know, like I felt like I got some of my money back, right? If I went out and bought a single player game, played it for 8 hours, enjoyed it, then got $30 back, I could put that $30 toward the next game, which I liked, mm-hmm. which you can't do in digital copies.
Can't.
But what I have found is you're talking about a digital, you're talking about a physical game collection. I'm building up a digital game collection. And these are games that I can go back to at any time. If I want to go back to Horizon Zero Dawn, then I just boot it up because it's sitting there on my hard drive. Even if I delete it off my hard drive, I can download it and play it in an hour, you know? Whereas before, in when I bought a disc-based game, I would have returned that thing months ago. I would no longer own that game, right? I would have gotten my $30 and
your options are gone. Yeah.
Right. So now they come out with DLC for Resident Evil. I'm like, oh, I got Resident Evil. I'm gonna check that out. I'm gonna check out that DLC. You know. So it's actually changed my gaming for the positive, and I don't have shelves of shit just filled up anymore.
All that space you can put kids in each corner. Shut up! You're talking back. Get in that corner. It used to be games. Get in that
game corner. But isn't that like the secret of life? Is like, you know, filling this big box you call a house with just, you know, more shit, more stuff.
Yeah.
So I think the real secret of life is get rid of all your shit and develop. You know, spend your money and your time developing relationships and experiencing the world instead of, you know, like it. It's a false prophet. You know, all your shit. It's an anchor that weighs you down.
Well, I tell you, when Ryder
has learned a lot here.
The game collection is a hard thing to move when you got to move if you have a sizable one. I mean, it took me an entire day, especially the complete in box stuff, man. I had to bubble wrap it and make sure it was all good. And, you know, it's just boxes and boxes of boxes and boxes of games, you know. So that was a huge, the first time I had to move with my collection, that was a huge turnoff, but I see it 50-50. Like, I agree with everything that you guys said about digital game releases, and you could always come back to them and stuff, but, man, I like physical cool stuff. Like, I have the vanilla Destiny Collector's Edition that, you know, my clan leader sent me because I was way more obsessed with the game than he was at the time. And, you know, same thing with, I did Taken King physical collector's edition. Yeah, right? Yeah, you know, and like just the little trinkets and stuff, and like, you know, pre-ordering and getting Cade and, you know, these little things. And yeah, man, all that kind of stuff is, it's the kid in me. I like
that's action, the stuff that figures sucks. Because you know, I collect action figures, and you know, I want these little extra trinkets that come with digital pre-orders and stuff. And like Briar has like the ghost from Destiny 1, and you know, his Dinklebot, you know, from the original Peter Dinklage. This kind of stuff I would love to have, but it's like at the end of the day, the pros outweigh the cons. Well, I can look over, or I know in the next room there's somebody else playing the exact same game. It's like I get the game for half price, or I get two copies for one. So for me, it's always, well, since I've been on PS4, it's worked out that way where I'm able to look past the trinkets and say, well, what am I getting for doing this digitally? You know?
Well, it's a good point, too. You brought up with like the ghost being Peter Dinklage's voice. Like, that's a time capsule of that. You know what I mean? Like, new players coming in aren't going to know how big of a deal that is. That, like, that, you know, he's no longer the voice of the ghost, which is fine.
Why do you call
him
Dinklebot? I don't get it.
Yeah. I like No-No-Bot as well for, you know, Nolan North, No-No-Bot. I like that as well. But I miss my Dinklebot, too. And I have that ghost, and he says things like, this place is amazing. And I love it, you know? Like, I love those little lines. Like, what about you, Gary? Where do you stand on this?
So, I've got a bit of an odd view around it. So, on console, I like physical. In fact, to be honest, on console, I'm shrinking the collection. I've sold most of my console games. I've still got some PS4 games that are limited. And on my Switch, I'm all physical because I like the little Switch boxes that the games come in. They're kind of like... I don't know
Vita,
how to describe
Vita,
them. Like,
Vita cases? Yeah,
they kind of look like that. And everything I've got on the Vita is physical. So I've got like 180 Vita games, all physical, just because I like to have them.
But
for PC, I've got about, I want to say about 450 titles on my hard drive at the moment.
Jesus Christ.
On the PC, all digital. Yeah. I have not bought a physical PC game probably in 8-9 years.
I wouldn't even know where to go get one.
Yeah, they used to have them at Best Buy like 10 years ago.
I've got a PC collector's edition of Destiny, you know, the one with the little man bag, you know, the little thing. Anyway, I've got one of them.
Okay. Yeah, Destiny 2. Okay. So there's that's a physical thing, or does it come with a download code?
Right, download code. Buy his, but it comes with the physical crap for the PC.
I think that's the way they're moving forward in the future. Is they're going to start separating the collector's edition bullshit, or not bullshit. I'm sorry, that's the wrong word. Like the goodies, you know, they're going to, that's actually going to be a separate purchase than buying the game, because they see that digital is moving the way forward too, but people still want the goodies. They still want the
A lot of PCs don't even have CD drives anymore. Like you'd have to get like a USB optical drive. Like they're not even sold with a drive. So I don't know, I'm conflicted. I can see why you'd do it. But for PlayStation, like Brian said, I like to have the residual value that I can trade something in, because generally I don't play PS4 games for very long. I play an exclusive and then I just send it straight back, because in the UK we've got a really good secondhand market. So in the UK you can buy a game and probably get about 75 to 80% of the value of it if you trade it back in.
Fucking UK. Like,
wow.
Pretty. Yeah, that's awesome. It's pretty good. So as well, we've got like legitimate secondhand stores, like stores that are, they'll only deal in secondhand games, but there'll be like a chain like GameStop. It's called CEX for anyone that's in the UK, and they deal in all secondhand merchandise. So there'll be a game that'll be like $60 at GameStop, and then they'll have like on the day of release, they'll have secondhand copies in this store for like $50, and then they'll buy it back for like $40. So you can buy a game for like $50,
complete it,
and the games cost you $10. So, but they don't do that with PC, because obviously once the code's burnt, code's gone. So for PC, I'm exclusively digital. But for, I don't know, for me, I know what you're saying, Briar, about having a big digital game library, but it's not the same on a PS4, because I don't have 10 terabytes of hard drive space that I can just store everything on. Whereas on a PC, I can do that, and it's all there, and it's ready to go.
With all due respect, many people who play on PCs don't have 10 terabytes of space to use. I mean, most people have maybe 2 or 3.
Even with Steam, I'll tell you what I do with Steam is I have a separate hard drive that's an SSD. I don't store many games on it because it's not that big a drive. I think it's 250 gigabytes. But I only load games onto that drive because I like how it loads much faster than having a spinning disk drive. So when I'm done with a game, I delete it off of that drive and download another one.
Yeah, gotcha.
I'm
going to
have
like
a Destiny 2 drive. I'm just going to have one drive that's just Destiny 2.
Really? Are you?
Yeah, I mean, I've got my SSD.
He's so fucking giddy about it.
Dude, I'm pumped.
Hard drive space cheap as shit on PC. Like, it's peanuts.
And you can just have a
7,200 RPM mechanical hard drive. You can get like a 4 terabyte one of them, 3 terabyte one of them dirt cheap. You can have 2 or 3 of them on your PC and you'll never run out of space. Yeah.
Ooh.
And then it's one. But for me, especially with content creators, they've all got so much space. I think the limiting factor for me on a PlayStation is one, cost, and two, space. So game share or not, I'm selfish. My partner plays, but she plays games that are so different to the taste that I have. We don't share. She plays things like League of Legends and other games of that nature that I'm not into at all. So for me, as a selfish person that plays on my own, game shares doesn't do it for me. It's not a motivator.
It helps. It definitely is a big thing with me, for sure. Like me and Sam, we share games all the time. We get into a lot of the same games. We have a lot of, a group of friends that get into the same kind of games. I mean, all of our friends from Destiny, we're all generally playing the same game for the most part. So being able to share it is pretty nice. But sometimes though, if I enjoy a game enough, I want a physical copy of it. And right now, currently, totally Destiny is that game where I want physical representations of it.
I bought I bought the collector's edition of Destiny, the disc-based version. And I got so fed up with having to carry the disc up and downstairs, I ended up just buying a digital version on top of that because I just wanted it loaded on my hard drive because I was so fed up. And for Destiny 2, I've pre-ordered the collector's edition, and I'm doing the same thing. I'm gonna actually play the digital.
I'm gonna be honest. If they released a physical box version of PUBG, I'd buy that again. Just to have the physical, if they did like a collector's edition of it, let's say. I don't know what they put in a collector's edition of it.
The big box PC games were fun as hell to buy. I'm not going to lie.
So much shit in them.
Like, yeah, and then like
you could hang on a wall and
I remember going and getting two-piece you're talking about, where it was like a cardboard A4 size box.
Mm-hmm. Well, the artwork on it, there was, you had to read the, you know, you'd get it, my mom would get me in the car, I'd be reading the back of the box, open it up, there's all the discs in there. And
manuals. Shareware.
Y'all remember Shareware?
Yeah.
That stuff was good, man. I miss Shareware.
Yeah, that old PC stuff was cool. I mean, I remember getting like cloth maps that you could hang on the wall. Like, you'd get manuals that were thick. You'd get like little trinkets in there, like keychains or, you know, like all sorts of weird stuff came in those things. And that was for just, that wasn't a special edition.
That was their stand.
Base.
That was just the version of the game that you bought at the store. It was really cool.
Yeah, the manuals and the maps were really cool, like you said, because it had so much lore and in-game stuff in it. And this is before the internet, like, was huge.
The internet,
yeah. TIE Fighter. I remember buying TIE Fighter. It came with, like, a book.
Yeah, I bought Star Wars Supremacy, which had, like, the picture of the... It was, like, an RTS Star Wars game. It had a picture of, like, the Star Destroyer on the front. And that came with, like, an encyclopedia to the Star Wars universe. It came with a cloth kind of... map that was like all of the star systems that the rebels had like drawn out and stuff. It's like amazing stuff. And that was that's probably been lost in the midst of time.
I still have my TIE Fighter novel.
I
still got the original World of Warcraft. You know the Prima strategy guides, the piggyback guides.
Yeah.
Yep.
I've got the original World of Warcraft one from 2002. Was it 2003? I've still got the original one of them, and inside it, this is how much of a fanboy I am, I've still got my jewel case that came with the pre-order and the receipt of the pre-order for World of Warcraft.
That's worth some money, Gary.
Still playing that game this week. I mean,
I put about 60 hours in this week.
Shit!
Damn, full-time job right there, working OT.
Yeah. Right?
Working OT on that WoW.
Over.
I still have all my old strategy guides, and I actually have this Legend of Zelda Link to the Past for Super Nintendo. It was actually a massive comic book. It was about as big as a player's guide and as thick as a player's guide, but it was all hand-drawn comic of the entire game.
Oh, really?
Every palace and everything. I still have it. Yeah, I'll have to let you guys check it out sometime.
Amazing.
It's really cool. Like, I miss that kind of stuff, man. I really do. Like, but I see it both ways. Like, I'm getting old. I got enough shit, and you know,
I don't want that shit in my house. But I'm glad there's somebody out there who's keeping track of it.
Tell him again, Briar. He said he's getting old. We already old.
The same thing for Destiny. So before we move on there as well, and the reason that I brought it up for WoW is strategy guides for those sorts of games are really, really fun, because I looked back at my Destiny 1 strategy guide, the collector's edition one that had like the picture of the Titan on the front of it. And the guides, like, in that, like, they're the talent trees as they existed and the weapons as they existed at launch. So you spoke, Wilson, about it being a time capsule locked.
Oh, wow, that's crazy.
That's what I love about the strategy guides, because the game has evolved.
Changed so
uncharacteristically
much.
And you've got something trying to tell you how to play at that time. It's so cool.
That's cool, man.
So cool to look back and see that. Yeah.
Very cool.
Carry on.
All right, so we got one last topic. You guys want to jump on it?
Monitors. I've been doing a lot of talk about monitors lately, a little bit on Twitter, a little bit on even DCP, all sorts of places. But I basically have been looking for a monitor that doesn't exist. I want it all. You know, I want my cake and I want to eat it too. So here are my requirements, right? Here's what I've been looking for. So I want something that can do 4K gaming, right? I want a 4K monitor, and I want it to have HDMI 2.0 so that it can hook up to a PlayStation and do 4K. Maybe even with HDR. HDR isn't that big a concern, but it'd be nice if it could do 4K gaming from a PlayStation at 60 frames per second. Because there are games, surprisingly enough, that do run on the PlayStation 4 Pro at 4K at 60 frames per second. Then I would also like it to have a DisplayPort that it can hook up to a computer and maybe run at 144 hertz. Maybe I'm not going to run 4K at 144 hertz, but I could down-res it to maybe 1440p, and run at 144 hertz, because running at a high refresh rate for a shooter is absolutely stunning. Like, I was playing Doom on a 240 hertz monitor, and it's so smooth. It's just insane. And it's the funny thing is, like, there's swings of from like 180 to 240, right, in that game. Like, it's swinging frame rates, right? You don't even notice it because it's running so goddamn fast.
So smooth, yeah.
That's that. Wow. That's what Tefty was saying. He said that's like his one of his go-to games for testing out a monitor because it's fast, it's very fluid, it's very smooth, and it's done very well.
And not only that, is I do believe it helps my aim. Like, I'm a better player of Doom. I'm a better player in PUBG with the faster refresh because, A, everything just looks smoother. So the acceleration of the mouse going across the screen and my aiming reticle coming to my target, it looks smoother, and I'm not, like, overshooting and, like,
adjusting or anything. Yeah, you're not going past,
So that's a factor. But also because the refresh of the rate of the monitor is faster, you're actually seeing your inputs a little bit faster. Now, I'm not a young man. And my reflexes are not as good as they once were. But I did have an experience where I was playing PUBG on a 60 hertz BenQ monitor. And one of the monitors I bought was 144 hertz, 1440p monitor. And I went out and I won the first game I played on the new monitor.
Yeah,
I was like, holy shit. I'm sure it's a coincidence, but it made an impression. You know? But it's so sure I've been going through this quest. I've bought 1080p monitors. I bought 1440p monitors. I bought 4K monitors. And none of them are really... There is no perfect monitor at this point for me anyway. So I had to... I settled on the 280 hertz 1080p monitor because... For PC gaming, it was kind of the clear choice for me as a content creator. If I was not a content creator, I probably would have gone with a 1440p because it's just a little crisper and you're getting most of the benefit of the higher refresh rate. But 4K is really where my heart's at. I want to play 4K and I like streaming at 4K, even though I'm down-resing it to 1080p or lower. I think 1440p, it looks fantastic. And if I can get to a happy medium, I believe the next version of graphics cards from NVIDIA that's coming out probably November-ish is going to be capable of high frame rates of 4K. You know, so that's really where I want to be, but all this stuff is just still, it's just like off. It's on the horizon. I needed out to buy now.
On the cusp.
Right, it's just off, and it's going to be expensive when it does come out.
Shit. Damn.
I mean, I don't know, it depends what. With monitors at the moment, I think there's a lot of focus on spec on the page and not so much of how it looks to the eye. So I think there's a definite difference between a 60 hertz monitor and a 120, 144 hertz monitor. 100% there is a difference. Going above that, the monitor that you've just bought for 1080p, completely get why you've done it as a content creator because it's native res as to what you're broadcasting. But to me, that is a... one use only monitor, and that is a Counter-Strike or Overwatch professional players monitor. That would be where I
will say this. So when I brought the it's 240, it can overdrive to 280. When I brought that monitor in, I still had the 144 hertz monitor here, so I was able to kind of play back to back. There was a pretty noticeable difference.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, I mean, playing them back to back, if I had a day between the two monitors, I probably would have said there's no difference. There's no visible difference. But because I was able, they were literally both sitting here, and I was able to plug the display port into one and then plug it into the other.
You noticed the difference. Wow.
There was a difference. It was noticeable. I don't know if it was significant to gameplay, but it was significant enough that I could see it.
Even though
the human
eye
can't see over 60 frames per second.
Human eye can't see more than 15 or so. For me,
is that stupidity, answer?
I've got to the point now where I spend a few good, you know, $100 on a decent 4K screen as well, like an Asus gaming range 4K screen that's 60 hertz. I will actively avoid playing on it because my two other screens are 144 hertz, the 1440p and the 1080p.
That's the problem to me, with 4K right now, especially on the PC, is that pushing that frame rate is not quite in the range of the current generation of video.
I know, I can do it with a 1080 Ti overclocked. I can maintain 60 on pretty much every game at Ultra. That's not the issue. It's that 60 frames per second doesn't look good enough. Like, to me, that is a garbage resolution. It is.
I hear everyone shooting for like 120 now for the standard.
Right. I play World of Warcraft at like 300 frames per second, but I can't see them. I can only see them at 144 hertz, and everything moves perfectly. You know, it's an old game, so it's not difficult to do. Everything feels good. I play Overwatch at 144 locked. Everything moves perfectly. Man. It's just a smoothness to the game that can't be described. Exact as Briar said, as you move, nothing's blurred. You know, your peripheral, you can see clear focus on everything around the edges of the screen. I come back to a 60 hertz monitor and I move my mouse across it, and it looks like the mouse is moving in slow motion. Like it's even a trail of mouse across, like mice cursors across it. It looks garbage. So when my game, if I'm dropping frames and I drop down to 70 hertz, like 70 frames, I notice it and I can look up at the frame counter and be like, oh, you know, that's not good. You know, I'm at 70 frames. This doesn't look and feel right.
As a console gamer, you guys are speaking language that I don't understand. I know what you mean. I hear where you're coming from. It's just mind-blowing to me that this is actually the reality that you guys are playing in. It's just crazy to me.
What's insane is, too, is that games are still targeting 30 frames per second.
Yeah.
That's the thing that's crazy. That's why when we found out that Destiny 2 was going to be 30 and not 60, that's why there was that was coming from people who'd seen 60 or had seen 120 or 144. Going back to 30, look, Destiny 2 running at 30, it's a fucking smooth 30. Like, that is a...
It really is.
It's a beautiful 30. But if it was running at 60 with lower fidelity, I'd be happier. Like, if that game didn't look as good but ran at 60, I'd be happier.
I mean, the thing is, right, for someone like me, I've never experienced a frame rate above 60, ever. And so to me, when I see a game that's running at 60, I notice it compared to a 30 frames per second game. But to hear you guys saying 120, 140, 200 frames per second, what world is this? And so it's really driving me to go ahead and get this this desktop, because I don't like you motherfuckers having shit that I don't have.
It's a slippery slope,
keep
too,
it
man.
Real here, man.
You become addicted to that frame
Jesus.
Counter, and yeah. you want to see triple digits in that frame counter at all time. And like, man, Tefty's really, really gotten into it as well, Briar, about, you know, monitors. I think even Patrick as well. And they'll be the first ones to tell you that. Yeah, I mean, it's a slippery slope. You're gonna want the As much time as you spend staring at a monitor, I mean, you might as well invest.
Yeah, that's part of it, too, is that not only am I literally staring at this monitor for at least 8 hours a day, but what I produce on that monitor then goes onto YouTube or onto Twitch and is, you know, viewed by other people as well. So to me, it's very much worth, you know, doing what I can. Content creation, this isn't a content creation monitor, right? I'm not doing color correction on videos on this monitor. It's not suitable for that. For that, I use a, you know, an IPS display that's, you know, got much better color reproduction. But playing on it, I mean, nice, man.
Yeah. And that's one of the reasons that you mentioned on your notes, WQHD. So, wide, you know, ultra wide screen. And have you guys seen the 21:9 monitors? They're like...
Yeah.
Super widescreen. BC Wilson, have you seen them? They're like...
No, I haven't, but that sounds interesting because I like I would like it widescreen like that.
So yeah. It's called WQHD is the tech. So imagine your monitor now, but then add no extra height, but add 6 inches extra of screen on the left and right side. So it's just an ultra, ultra wide screen. So what it does in first-person shooters and adventure games is give you a super wide field of view. So you can see things in your horizon that other people can't see. And it's really useful for first-person shooters, for target acquisition. And PUBG, I've got a friend who plays on WQHD.
Oh, yeah.
Because he can see that horizon line far, you know, far further than I can. The thing that puts me off getting one of them, aside from the fact I've got a triple monitor set up and they don't really fit in there, is that hertz limiter. Because you need to have so many more pixels on screen and it's harder to get the frames, the monitors tend to be locked at 60 hertz. So
some of them are 144 though, aren't they?
You can get some, but they're incredibly expensive, and to get the 144 is difficult to do. So you're not on 2560x1440; you're at 3840x1440 to manage the size of it. So it's almost like over 4K res to get a 1440p pixel density. so it tends to be difficult to get the actual the graphics card that can push the frames.
Now, but for me,
sorry, just to make the point there around why I think for monitors that hurts limit is so important is for me, I won't even consider them because generally speaking, they've got that 60 hertz cap. So, you know, it's that much of a big deal for me.
Peasant play. We understand here.
It is.
So what you're saying is the dream is to get three of them and then not even move your mouse, just move your head is what you're...
Yeah.
Is that...
That's all I have for him, yeah. This is, I think, Breyer's question. He didn't get around to asking it, though. Will 2018 be the year of 4K monitors with high frame play?
Like, yeah, they are coming out. They're scheduled to come out by the end of this year, and I was trying to not buy a monitor before these things came out, to be honest with you, because that's what I want. I want a 4K. I'd love a 4K IPS display that ran 144 hertz. That, to me, is the perfect monitor. That I could plug my PlayStation into, that I could plug my
PC into,
and it was just one gaming monitor for everything. And if I wanted to run a high refresh rate Destiny 2, I could bump it. You know, I could bump the in-game resolution down to 1440p, get plenty of sharpness, great picture, and still run a high refresh rate. If I wanted to record Destiny 2 for YouTube at 4K, I could bump it up, run 60 frames per second, and boom, you know. You're good to go. To me, that monitor is the most useful and the most, but it's just not available
versatile,
yet. And when it does,
yeah.
When it does come out, the thing's gonna cost $1,500.
Fuck.
Like, there's no doubt it's gonna cost $1,500 because it's got to have HDMI 2.0. It's got to have DisplayPort. Is it 1.2 or 1.4? Is the newest one?
1.4.
It's got to have an IPS display, which costs money. It's got to have 144 hertz, which costs money. 4K obviously costs money. G-Sync, which is a $200 charge, like on top of whatever monitor you're buying instead of getting FreeSync. And you want G-Sync, especially if you're going to have issues maintaining that frame rate. Like, it's going to be expensive.
Is there anything competing with 4K right now?
Like the next 8K. Level? 8K.
Are you serious?
So, how long of a life do you think said monitor will have? The
Five
one that you're
years?
Talking about.
The problem with 8K is that content delivery is still having trouble for 4K, right? It's like you're still, like, if you want to get a TV that's 4K, you're still looking at very few limited sources to get actual 4K content. You got to buy physical discs like Ultra HD Blu ray. You got to buy, you can do YouTube, which will deliver sort of 4K. It's, you know, it's a blocky 4K, but it looks pretty good. Netflix will do it. Same kind of deal, though. It's coming down. But there's, like, TV stations aren't even planning on swapping to it. They just swapped to 1080p, and that was an exorbitant cost for, you know, like, the ABCs, the CBSs, like, those. They just swapped over to 1080p. They're not planning on 4K anytime soon. It's going to, you know, there's not the bandwidth for them either because they just swapped over the cable systems to, you know, digital cable and enough room in each, you know, in each segment of cable bandwidth for each channel to have 1080p signals, not 4K.
Right? 4K, so it's like
content delivery for 8K, that's going to be a while.
Right.
We're looking at years. Boy.
Yeah, I mean, the TVs, the monitors are already out there. You can get an 8K monitor. TVs, you're not going to see those at Best Buy for a while, my guess is.
Yeah, I mean, you can do DSA, like the new NVIDIA graphics cards allow you to dynamic super sampling. So you can run a game at 8K, which will super sample it down to 4K. So you get twice the pixel density on the image. You can take that down right the way to 1080p. So you can run a game at 8K right now. Your frame rate will be garbage unless it's a ancient game, but it's possible.
So basically, we have some room to grow with 4K. So you could invest in one, and it wouldn't be the next best thing a year later, or whatever.
I have a 4K monitor on my desk right now. It's not the most high end thing. It'll run 60 frames per second for PlayStation or for a computer. It's a TN panel, so the colors aren't as accurate as an IPS display, but it looks pretty damn good. I run Destiny 2 on it in 4K, and I gotta say, it looks really good. And I got that for under $400 at Best Buy.
Nice.
You know, it's a pretty nice monitor.
Well, I know who I'm talking to before I buy my monitor. I'll have to talk to you guys.
You got that right.
So.
$400. That's what I'll give my son at his wedding. All right.
Could have got him a monitor.
Yeah.
I give you the gift of 4K and retina happiness.
4K, bro. That's all you got to say. 4K, bro.
4K.
Give him the gift of 144 hertz. He'd be far happier.
Before we bring Revolver Episode 1 to an end, I wanted to remind people of exactly what we're doing here. Revolver is a gamecast that is centered on six topics that can range from the hottest gaming news to nerd culture. So that involves everybody out there. As a start, we want the show to promote debate and thoughtful discord, and we want your feedback. So submit your viewer feedback where you can suggest topics and changes to the show at the email. Our email is...
Or if you want to weigh in on last week, like if you got something to say about the SNES Classic or Destiny 2, We're going to take that into consideration at the beginning of next week's episode. So we'll be reading your emails at the beginning of the episode and talking about what you guys had to say and how wrong Gary was about
He's always wrong.
Everything. I mean, so the way we do this is basically said that the topics had to be video games and nerd culture. I wanted the 10 hottest male celebs of 2017. They wouldn't let me do it. I was pretty pissed. So if there's any support in chat,
because you wouldn't put me on the list, goddammit.
Yeah, so
it's males in America, you'd be straight on there, but it's the celebs.
Yeah, we put it in the backlog, it's there.
Yeah, it's definitely in the backlog. If you guys would like to share your own topics for the show, your thoughts, or your changes to the show, do so at www.revolvergamescast@gmail.com. That is our email. You can also hear the podcast version of the show on iTunes or your favorite podcast service. All you do is search Revolver Live, and that's how you'll find us. And that's all I have to say.
All right, let's do some outros. Wilson, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter, Ryu Wilson. And other than that, you can pretty much find me hanging out at Briar's Chat. So look out for me.
I will.
Oh, yeah.
I will. Yeah, you're going to see him, I'm sure. You guys know me. I'm the Beastly Gamer. You can always search the Beastly Gamer YouTube channel. Find me there. Or your latest, greatest new hip-hop artist. Fuck you, Drake. What about you, Gary?
I am Gary Diaz. You can find me on Twitter at GaryDiaz86_BT. The BT stands for Big Thuggin', if anyone's asking. That's my hip-hop name.
We knew it.
So, yeah, hit me up on Twitter if you want to do any ASMR or any sort of chat of that nature, I'm down. So continue along.
I'm Briar Rabbit. You can find me on YouTube or Twitch. Just search Briar Rabbit, or you can find me on Twitter at the Briar Rabbit. Thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to send that feedback. We really want it. And we'll see you next week.
Please send nudes.
He always wants nudes, bro. He wants nudes.
Thought there was nothing left for you to do with your night. The Revolver Podcast, Mama Hot Flash, crew is hot, always doing you right. With a fresh take on gaming weekly, PCs, consoles, and handhelds. Bump what you heard since birth on this earth. We know that the future belongs to the nerds. Revolver Live.
What you say?
Revolver Live, every Sunday at 6, bringing that gaming magic to your life. Doing it live on Twitch, the show that you don't want to miss. Be sure to subscribe. Crack yourself a brew. If it work, are you who? Now you can join the crew for the ride.
Xbox, mobile, and hot topics around the nation, to gaming rigs, headsets, hardware, and PlayStation. Shout out to Joe, can't you see him glow? Token brother brought the flow. Now it's time for the show.
Let's go.